Yo, what's going on, guys? It's your boy Synsei Inc. And today I am back with part two, the continuation to me and Joyboy's collab. In the last one that we did, we talked a lot about the sun god Nika and Luffy inheriting the will of a god. Well, halfway through this collab, me and Joyboy switched the topics up and we started talking about things that happened pre-Void Century and where these people of the ancient kingdom may have truly came from. This is a little bit of a tinfoil theory. It's out there, as you can see in the thumbnails. You probably are wondering, aliens? But there are different moons, probably different planets, and there's a whole vast world in One Piece that's probably not been explored yet. But before we get into today's video, if you guys want to help me out by liking the video, that would be so awesome and I'd appreciate it. The like goal for this video will be 1,000 likes. If we get there, that would be great. Also, if you want more One Piece content like this, make sure you subscribe and turn on those post notifications. Let's get into the video.
The something I mentioned, you know, beforehand, and something me and Cole talked about a little bit was the whole moon situation, right? So not just specifically the moon thing, but it goes hand in hand with the moon thing. Our mindset was that in the ancient kingdom era, Void Century, maybe pre-Void Century, there had to have been technological advances already made beforehand. And what I mean by this is, unless somehow these people were just evolutionized on the moon already, which I don't think that's the case, they had to have gotten to the moon somehow, which means that there was probably already vehicles to get to and from at some point. Now, we know that Enel had the Arc Maxim, which he used to get there. But it's like, if he could have gotten his hands on this, there's probably other people that could have come up with technology to get to the moon and from. There's robot pirates on the moon, right? So you're like, okay, there's that. And I think that is enough evidence for me to think that there is other either life forms or maybe, and I know this is getting crazy talking about aliens and stuff, but
it's not crazy, but
when people hear the word alien, I think that they automatically think like the weird aliens and UFOs and stuff like that. But like, technically an alien could be any life form that's just not from, you know, Earth or, you know, anything. Like, it doesn't have to be some crazy extraterrestrial. It could just simply be people from different planets that, you know, may or may not look like us. It doesn't really matter. But my point is, there probably exist, in my opinion, people from other planets and or the moon. And I just kind of want to know what you think about all of that. And I know that's a lot to take in, a lot to talk about.
It's not specific at all. It's like, go off, JB.
Yeah.
But, you know, so like you said, right, like, I think you're coming with the assumption, right, that life originated on, they call it the blue planet, right? Planet that the story is focused on, but that's not necessarily true, right?
Exactly.
Life could have originated on a moon, right? One of the moons. There's this weird globe that's in Clover's office in O'Hara, and a lot of people pointed it out. Maybe you've seen it, but you know, it shows the planet being circled by, I think it's like eight celestial bodies, and people presume it's eight moons just because of the way, you know, small little rocks surrounded by a big rock, right? They're probably moons, but you know, you could make this more complicated, right? Maybe the world of One Piece doesn't yet understand that, you know, their world isn't the center of the universe, right? So those actual, it's like geocentric rather than solar centric. So then those are not moons, but actual planets within the solar system. But, you know, even going back to, like you said, well, technology, you know, they needed technology to go from the planet right to one of the moons. You know, when we see the moon, Enel's moon, which was abandoned over 900 years ago, over 1,000 years ago, right? That, I mean, they had automata, I think that's how you pronounce it. You know, those little machine guys, right? In Enel's cover story. And that were only recently reinvented on the blue planet by Dr. Tsukiyomi, which was also in a cover story. So it's like, you know, 1,000 years ago, they had technology that would have been futuristic, you know, 500 years ago. And as far as this world, so it's almost like the Dark Ages, right? Like you technologically regressed from the Void Century and somewhere in the middle here. And we're only just now, the world's only now catching up to where it once was, you know? So But that's really interesting. But anyway, in Anel's cover story, right, there's actual aliens, right? That's what they are. They're space pirates. That's, yeah. You know, and you look at them, they're not, you know, it's not, they're not a race that we recognize. And they're just literally just cruising around. So there's an entire world up there, clearly, you know, whether, and it's like interesting, like how do they interact with the planet? Did, you know, you see celestial dragons, right, in spacesuits. I don't think that's coincidence. I don't think go to, you know, it's like, oh, we don't want to breathe your air, right? But it would make even more sense if the celestial dragons were either believed themselves or were actually from space originally, and they came down to the planet. It makes me personally wonder. I think that there's, you can turn this either way, right? Like the races, like fishmen and minks and stuff are from the moons and they came to the planet, or you can reverse it. They're actually from the planet originally, and then humans came from elsewhere and invaded their territory, you know?
Yeah.
And you know, so, and then like you start building this, right? Or at least I start building this, and then you start really, I think it's, you can start building headcanon for why there might have been conflict, right? So you have this world, maybe, this is my personal belief anyway, that the fishmen were actually from here. This is their planet. And then the humans, like the celestial dragons, came from elsewhere. Maybe there's an entire space civilization, you know, and they came down here. And then what did they do? You know, we're superior. You know, we're technologically advanced and we're going to conquer. You're, you know, it's no different than what's happened in real history. Let's just be quite frank about it. And so, you know, you start conquering. And when you start doing that, conflict happens. And then maybe that's what leads up to the void century and the fishermen, yeah, and the various groups being enslaved, and you know, all the things that, you know, we don't yet know for sure but are starting to be hinted. But yeah, yeah, you sure told me. Yeah, I mean, I feel like there's so much more that could be said though.
Yeah, yeah. So let me ask you this then, with that, not that kind of concept of them perhaps being from the moon or being from, you know, another planet, whatever those things are on the globe, as you mentioned, is it possible that Joy Boy could have been also an alien?
Yeah. I mean, it could be anybody, right? It could be anybody. I think, you know, a lot of people say, right, because of the whole space stuff that we learned in Anel, that means that the Straw Hats are going to space. That was like a really popular theory. It's kind of also a meme-worthy theory as well. Yeah. Straw Hats in space. but, you know, I tend to think that it doesn't have to be true, right? It could just be true because it helps explain why the world is as it is. You know, it's like it is part of the history that is going to be revealed and become relevant. You know, another theory that I really like that's related to this is, you know, we see Anel's world, or where the Skypeans left, right? And their, yeah, world at one point was habitable, right? They lived there, and then at some point their little moon died. And they were forced to leave. That's why they got little balloons or whatever, you know, and they floated back down supposedly to the blue planet because they had to leave because the world was being destroyed. But I have a theory. This is really cool. I don't know how big of a Dragon Ball fan that you are.
I love Dragon Ball.
But my favorite movie was, I'm going to forget the name, with Turles. Oh, man. But anyway, it was one of the first Dragon Ball movies. And the idea was there's Turles, a guy who looked just like Goku, was Goku's brother, I think, or something like that. Obviously, a lot of Saiyans kind of looked like Goku. You know, that's how it was. But but anyway, there was this fruit that you planted on a planet and it grew. Tree of Might. That's what it was.
The Tree of Might. Yeah.
Yeah. And so it grew this tree that sucked all the life from the world and produced a fruit that had power, that you ate the fruit and it made you stronger. And that was the whole like plot of the movie. Turles wanted to plant the Tree of Might and then take the fruit and eat it to make himself stronger. And so there's, you know, Oda obviously is on record as being a huge fan of Dragon Ball, cites that as pretty much the number one inspiration for One Piece. So it'd be really cool if he got inspiration for the devil fruits from the Tree of Might, right? Where you plant a tree that sucks the life out of the world in some way, maybe not as obvious as Tree of Might, but, you know, in a subtle way, and then produces a fruit that gives you power. So then you look at like Anel's world, or the winged people's world, right? So, you know, it had life and then at some point it didn't, right? And so then why did the humans who lived out in space leave their world in order to come to this planet? Well, maybe, you know, devil fruits killed it. And the devil fruits are actually from space as well, and aliens. So
yeah, that could be a potential. And then the devil fruits, either they brought them here with them, or a lot of them were devil fruit users, perhaps.
Right. Or they just have the fruits. Right. Once you have the fruit, they like reincarnate. So maybe the fruits were from elsewhere and they brought them here, you know, and then sort of cycle repeats or something like that.
Yeah. Because like if the whole theory of like the devil fruit spawning and like different fruits upon like the death of the user, if that is true, or like at least what it really is similar to that, then that could make sense that they could have brought the fruits here, you know, by eating them and being devil fruit users. Because over time, these people would die, which means the fruits would be passed on. So like
become a new. Yeah.
Yeah. So like because people always because there's a lot of theories about devil fruits, how they originated and things like that, and how did they end up getting all over the world. And it's like, well, if they spawn to different locations after, or to the nearest fruits or whatever it may be, after the person dies, it has it, then over time, it's like all these devil fruit users, they're not going to stay in one place. They're probably going to travel all over the world. And after enough time has passed, the devil fruits themselves would also end up all over the world. So like, it just makes sense.
You know, an extension of this theory as well that I made in a video a long time ago was that, you know, how does the Skypeans have the lightning Logia fruit, right? So it seems kind of a natural. Did some strong devil fruit user die up in the Sky Islands, or was it a fruit that the Skypeans or the winged people have always had, right? And so you go to the moon civilization with the automata, man. I gotta think about that every time. But you know, like you go to their world, they got little like electricity bulbs there. When you actually look at the cover panel, and there's like pipes, electricity pipes that are like running around. And so Anel, immediately when he gets there, his fruit is like perfect because it turns the city back on, right? It's like he can just zap it, right? And then all of a sudden, this moon, which has been abandoned for 1,000 years, has power again. So it's like maybe this fruit was, you know, originally on that moon, that it's always been a winged people fruit that has been passed down for, you know, this entire time. And that's why
it just happened to get to the wrong person.
Eventually. Yeah. Right. Yeah. Crazy lunatic. But yeah, you know, so that's pretty cool to me too.
Yeah, for sure, man. I think how I want to end this conversation, Joyboy, we talked a little bit about ancient Kane. We talked about some Sunganika and stuff. I kind of just want to like pick your brain as far as emu goes. And the thing that's interesting about emu to me, and something that I've always assumed about emu, is that emu, and correct me if I'm wrong, but we don't have any confirmation in the story, correct, that emu is definitely from the Void Centuries. That's just something that people assume.
That's just something people assume. We don't know for sure.
Yeah, so I always just thought about that, about emu in general, and I just didn't know because I'm new, kind of new. I wouldn't say I'm completely new now to the One Piece community. I'm like, but only been in it for about 2 years. So I don't know where a lot of these theories originate from. I was just wondering if you could fill me in on like where this whole, the whole emu being a part of like the Void Century kind of sparked from. Like, is there a specific idea that came from?
Yeah. So for the longest time, even before emu was revealed, people have been wanting, this is actually the theory that predated it, that the Gorosei were from the Void Century. That was the big theory for a number of years. And the basic thought of it was, you know, I mean, there's some small details, right? Like we see the Gorosei during the destruction of Ohara, which was, you know, like 23 years ago, something like that. So that was a long time ago. And the Gorosei membership has not changed since then. We can see all the members just the same. And they're kind of silhouetted, but they don't look any younger either, which was kind of like, oh, okay, so they don't age, right? I think that's kind of debunked now. I think people were kind of reaching for that. But that was sort of the thought that really took off when it was revealed that Law's Opi Opi no Mi has a special ability of perennial youth or immortality. And so that's just something that I think people want, is they want the Opi Opi no Mi to have been used at least one time on somebody to make somebody immortal or use the power of the fruit, right? That's why it's so prized, because people know what it can do. You know, if you know what it can do, then it must have been used.
Yeah, and I think
at some point in time.
What's interesting about the OPOP, you know me, and something that I've always wondered and thought about was, people always, you know, nowadays that I talk to them about the fruit, they assume that the immortality surgery got brought up due to the fact that the fruit is going to end up being used on someone. But I always thought, like, it doesn't necessarily have to be that. It could have gotten brought up and explained to us because later on we'll find out, like you said, it was used on someone in the past. It doesn't necessarily mean that it has to be used in the story again on someone else. It could be the other way around, that it's already been used and Oda brought it up, so when he explains it to us later, we're not confused about it. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean, it's just like the moon thing. Absolutely, 100%. It can go either way, right? And, you know, it'd be kind of cool if it went both ways too, but, yeah. You know. But yeah, I mean, it doesn't have to be anything that, so. Yeah, that's why it's so, this conversation is so open-ended, right? Because you were kind of going down a path here a little bit, but, you know, it's like, man, it's like, if you were Oda, I wouldn't want to. Yeah. There's so much you could do.
No, for sure.
It's a little overwhelming.
So basically, in a nutshell, the Gorosei theory happened first after the OPOP no Mi got, you know,
pretty
the
much, extra yeah, ability got blew revealed. Up, yeah.
And then when Emu came around, then people kind of moved it to Emu in a way.
Yeah, that's my understanding. I mean, that makes sense to me anyway.
See, that's really interesting, because I always would talk about Emu as if Emu was 100% from the Void Century. And like in the last, I'd say maybe 3 months or so, as I've been doing more research and rereading things in One Piece, I was like, there is no piece of information in this story that says that Emu is from the Void Century. It's just something that so many people just assume and say that I just believed it.
And right. Like, yeah, I mean, I was like, wait a second.
Yeah, I'm rereading so many things to work on, you know, other videos and other theories I have. And I'm just like, There's nothing here saying, oh, I'm from the Void Century. I just assumed it to be true because so many people assume it. All right, and just say it.
Yeah, you got to be careful of your assumptions. Here's another theory to throw out at you, right? You know, maybe the Opiopi no Mi didn't make him immortal, but what about other kinds of fruits, right? So, like, you know, I like this whole inherited will thing and, like, souls and stuff. You know, like Luffy has the same, I mean, reincarnation is big in Eastern philosophy in general, but particularly in Japan, I mean, Shintoism, Buddhism, those are concepts that they believe in. So there being a Luffy, like straight up Luffy's soul existing in the past, right? That works. So then Emu doesn't have to be necessarily from the Void Century, but could be this sort of, they found who this person, you know, like there's some process that the world government secretly has to sort of find the person that's now housing the, you know, somebody like Luffy, but on the other end of the spectrum and make them king, you know, but they're actually, you know, not that old. Or on the flip side, maybe this particular soul has found a way to, you know, retain its memories from all of its different lives or something like that. Maybe that's a devil fruit or something like that. So, it could be as crazy like that too, you know, so.
Yeah, no, sit for back. Sure. Yeah, man, it's not easy to not assume things sometimes, because especially when you get so invested, you're like, man, you just want it to be right. Oh, this is 100% going to be the case, but it's like you want it to be so bad. But I think that could also be end up a bad thing too, because a lot of times in our community, and I'm sure you've seen it, people will assume something so much, and that they just truly believe in it, and this is just what it is. And then when Oda goes a different route, they get upset because their expectations aren't met. So it's like, I think it's important for people to have expectations and important for people to hope for things. But like, even myself, I've done this before, and I haven't like gotten to that point where I'm like mad at Oda, but I have been just disappointed because I was like hoping for something so much and then it didn't happen. I was like, man. You know, so I think it's kind of a double-edged sword when we have minds like ours that like are all constantly thinking about what ifs and, you know, different things and getting invested into different theories and stuff like that. It's interesting.
Yeah, I mean, you can't really stop people from doing that, right? Like, nope. It's impossible. You it's know, impossible. I mean, you enjoy you enjoy, you know, following one piece. You can like, I mean, you're not going to stop me from reading a chapter and then being like, oh, how does that work? And then finding something and being like, wow, I really want that. Yeah, you know, I think in general, people are pretty good that when their assumptions are based on essentially nothing, you know, like the Gorosei being immortals. Right. Yeah. You know, they let go of that pretty well. I think where it gets toughest is when Oda sort of sets the expectation, you know, and he does that. Right. And then he subverts it. So, like, for instance, a great example that I commonly, you know, talk about or see is Big Mom. When Big Mom is first truly revealed in Fishman Island, Oda sets some expectations, you know, for, OK, Big Mom drooling. She's eating people. She's scary. You know, she's going to be a certain way, intimidating, you know, sort of. Fulfill the, you know, everybody wants a Yonko to be like Doflamingo or Whitebeard or Crocodile, sort of, you know, those are the characters a lot of people like. That's the trope. And then you get Big Mom, who's kind of, you know, she's a running joke. Let's just be honest, right? You know, not just in terms of the things that she does in the story, but also that's kind of her purpose, right? It's very clear that Oda's like, all right, Big Mom is going to be the funny Yonko. And so, you know, so, but you start off with this initial expectations, then Oda subverts it and goes in a different direction that he wants to, and people like me enjoy it, but not everybody does. So it's like, creates this platform of being like, you know, feeling like you're justified in being mad. So, you know, at the end of the day, I always say this, man, just chill out, you know, like let him tell his story.
Exactly.
I mean, you can prefer, I mean, you can prefer things or not, you know, you like what you like. It's not going to change, but I mean, there's no need to let it, you know, get under your skin. I feel like some people kind of, you know, their whole, you know, it's like it's content almost, you know, to be outraged, you know, get interactions.
Yeah, for sure, man. Like, especially, you know, Twitter, social media and stuff like that. It's like,
right, yeah,
you know, drama sells, bro. You know, so it's like, oh, I'm outraged, you know, and it, and even if you don't get a bunch of people agreeing with you, just them reacting to the tweet is going to get it shown to other people. You know, that's just how the algorithm works on most things. So it's just how it is. Sometimes I think some of it is some people let it get out of hand. But then I agree with you. I think sometimes it's not that people are really that mad. They just know that that's just like what sells.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So,
yeah. Well, I mean, it's entertainment, right? You know, a lot of people, you know, what are you going to do? You know, you're on the app, right? You got this thought. You don't really like it. It's like, oh, let's tweet about it. Oh, somebody responds to you. They don't agree. All right, let's troll them. You know, it's like, so, but we don't actually know these people, right? It's so different. This is why internet is so different, right? If you're sitting in the room with somebody and they got, you know, certain body language, expression, they can say stuff like this. And even if you really love it, right, you can be like, laugh. All right, you know, right. You know, but you say it, you know, it's like, you can't catch that, you know, the little hints of not being serious or sarcasm in some of the tweets, and then all of a sudden it's like personal. It's like, exactly. I think the same way, it's like a lot of people think people are stupid, you know, they say some dumb shit on, you know, wherever it might be, and you know, it's, yeah, people are just sometimes bad at communicating, or you know, just don't care to communicate that they're joking, right? So then you just have this perception of you of being surrounded by idiots.
No, for sure, man. It's just something that happens. That's just social media in a nutshell. And I've slowly been learning that, especially with becoming like a content creator. And as you said earlier, I'm starting to now kind of feel what it's like to have like a small fan base. And like, you know, things are starting to slowly change. And I'm starting to see things a little bit differently on the other end, where before I felt like I could just be like, whatever, bro, I'll just say whatever. But now I'm kind of like, man, I really want to say this thing, but I feel like, man, I know what's going to come with it. And it's like, it's just like, oh, bro. And then it just,
Sanji versus Zoro.
So, you know, I just kind of stay away from certain things. I'm still myself, of course, but it's just like, bro, it's just like sometimes you can walk that tightrope, but it's like, you don't want to always, bro, tip it over, you know?
Bro, I still do it. I don't know. It's self.
I know,
man.
You do, bro. When I seen the Yamato tweet.
Yeah, that's a good one. It's like, shit. You know what? Anybody with, okay, let's just full honesty here. You can keep this on here. All right. So you know, this is obviously a huge issue for some people. But at the same time, I'm like compelled to discuss it, right? I was like, okay, you know, like, what's the truth? What's the situation here? Is it the political issue or is it not? And I say this stuff and I feel like everybody else in the community just, Arter is kind of the same as me as well, where he's talks, but you know, it's like Roger's base, for instance, he gets, you know, it's like, let's just never bring this up ever. And we're all happier for it. And I wish that I wish I had that mindset, man. What I tweeted about Yamato and then Yamato went trending on Twitter. Yeah.
See, the thing is I seen your tweet and then but the thing is, I know you. So I see your tweet and I said, huh, this is just Joyboy being Joyboy. But other people that don't know you.
Right. Yeah. They don't know me.
They go all the way to the left and they think that you're being bigot and like you're. And I'm just like, oh, my God.
Transphobic. Bro. Yeah. That was it. Transphobic.
Like, bro, like, come on, son. Yeah. It's just funny. It's just funny.
I just want to discuss it, man. Like, no ill feelings.
That's the thing, though. I do. I will defend my One Piece brothers. And that's just how it is, bro. The One Piece YouTube community, if I know for a fact that if someone, not even just you, but if someone tweets something or says something and it comes off a certain way, but I know who they are, when people bring that up to me, I keep it, you know, the same energy. I'm like, look, man, it's just Joyboy, bro. He's just being Joyboy. It's not anything. He's not trying to be transphobic. He's not. That's not the point. He just really wants to know the truth. It's a difference. You know what I mean? So I think that's what's important. It's not like, I feel like people took it like, oh man, he's tweeting that to be, you know, ignorant.
Right.
So, no, it's like, no, he just really wants to know what it is.
Like, right, is it this or that? And I'm letting people know, you know, like I've been thinking about this. I mean, you feel free to discuss. I'm all about it. But, you know, like, this is what I've been thinking. This is what I'm going to do. And I'm making it public so you can say stuff if you want to. And I don't got a problem with that. You know, I had an interesting conversation with Brago the other day as well. Because we did a collab video.
Yeah, I watched a little bit of it.
And monologuing JB once more. I think it was before or afterwards we had a conversation similar to this, and he was basically like, "That's why I don't engage in arguments or discussions like that on Twitter, because it doesn't, you know, it doesn't end up like you want it to, you know. So you can't convince anybody differently. So there's, you know." Somebody's get their feelings hurt, it becomes an arena, like a battlefield, right, where you got to win. And I definitely get that, you know, but I can't.
it's pointless, bro. It's pointless. But yo, JB, thank you so much, man, for coming on and doing this video. So happy that, you know, we got to, you know, do it at the right time and both of us were awake. I feel like every time we're supposed to do something, not every time, but sometimes we're supposed to do something, either you fall asleep or I fall asleep, man. But we're good now. We're here. We got it done, you know, so that's all that matters, bro.
Yes, sir.
But thank you so much, man. Like I said, for coming on the channel, guys, make sure that you check out Joyboy's channel. It'll be in the description below. Awesome content over there. Super cool art on his videos, man. The guy Revujo, right? That's his name.
Revujo. Follow Revujo on Twitter.
Follow him. That man, his art's crazy. I gotta catch him when he's got some commissions open and get something done, man. Just to have it, bro, because he's sick with it, man. I'm not gonna lie. But yeah, JB, thank you so much, man. And to everyone watching this video, I hope you guys have an amazing rest of the day or night whenever you're watching this. And I will see you all in the next video.